that is democratically run by Boston's working class communities of color. Boston Ujima Project is a concrete solution. We are creating our own agendas, and we are implementing those agendas ourselves, rather than constantly reacting to other people's agendas against us. We are coming together and pooling our resources in a community fund where every member has an equal vote on the businesses, real estate, and other community initiatives that we will invest in, that are not only owned by us, but also good for us. And we are ensuring the success of our investments by supporting them with going out of our way to shop at those businesses, advocating for policies that support our communities, like paying a living wage, and pushing large institutions to contract with our businesses, treat our workers justly, and give back to our communities, creating a cooperative economics infrastructure that allows us to meet our needs. Ujima, one of the seven principles of Kwanzaa, is Swahili for collective work and responsibility. Boston Ujima Project is a collective, concrete solution. And as Ujima is not the realm of a solo visionary leader, I must acknowledge several members of the Boston Ujima Project Collective. Our co-founder, Aaron Tanaka. Our steering committee members, Lisa Owens, Deborah Freeze, Darnell Johnson, Maura Holmes, Hendrix Berry, Maya Gall, and Sarah Jimenez. Our fund manager, Lucas Turner Owens. Our fellows, Kiara Mark, Katrina St. Flavin, Rafael Feliciano, Arthur Thomas, Tina Marie Johnson, and Ty Gentry. Our Neighborhood Economic Study Group creator and facilitator, resident co-op expert and thought partner, Stacy Cordero of Boston Center for Community Ownership. Our Neighborhood Economic Study Group participants, Ruby Reyes, Shamia Tibet Turner, Joyce Clark, Adam Anuto, and Mia Johnson. Our Divest Reinvest Fellow, Sarah Jacks. Our grassroots partners, City Life Leader Urbana, Black Economic Justice Institute, Matahari Women's Worker Center, Restaurant Opportunity Center United, the City School, and Alternatives for Community and Environment. Our Good Business Alliance members, Agaric, Bon Me, Bowdoin Bike School, Sarah Co-op, Democracy Brewing, Dorchester Food Co-op, Fresh Food Generation, Haley House, Life Force 2.0, Care Management Temporary Staffing Agency Incorporated, Norma Rosario Catering, Olio Culinary Collective, Restoring Roots Co-op, and Sydney Jamie Design. Our informal arts and cultural network partners, Jax Hill, Sierra Peters, and Sarah Majoui. Our technical assistance partners, Lawyers Committee for Civil Rights and Economic Justice, and the Center for Women in Enterprise. Our faith-based collaborators, Temple Israel and Moish Kavad. Our 268 members in Boston proper, around the country, and in Canada. And more. Our collective is large. We pause one moment to honor and thank one member of our collective, Libby Cohn, who is moving to New York City next week, for her integral research and creativity that has shaped our democratic process and outward communications. This is Libby over here. Thank you very much. Why a lecture series? Why not a highly designed charrette? A major influence in my life is Martin Luther King Jr. According to his autobiography, King began to intentionally reflect on how to bring about social change when he was a student at Crozier Theological Seminary. He studied closely Plato, Aristotle, Rousseau, Hobbes, Bentham, Mill, Locke, Walter Rauschenbusch, I can't read my writing, Nietzsche, Reinhold Niebuhr, and Gandhi. He was after four things during his study. the function and responsibilities of religion, the correct characterization of society and its ills, the most appropriate response to oppression, and an understanding of human drives. King concluded that religious leaders were obligated to address the spiritual and material well-being of their congregations, advocate for the poor, and reject the status quo, that in capitalism lay the danger of undervaluing collective effort, that love can be a powerful tool to bring about social change, and that humans possess capacities to rationalize things, as well as make improvements in behavior. I pause here to ask, when we consider today's movements, and the people from various walks of life who are participants, students, lawmakers, clergy, workers, academics, artists, journalists, educators, what study is necessary? What do we need to understand? We resist, we fight, we create, we play. We are all experts. We know, we be, and there's more to know. Let's give ourselves space to be still. Let's hear, let's process. Let's accept the work and gifts of our peers. We deserve it. Why Black Trust? Boston Ujima Project is making a commitment to lend to, finance, invest in businesses, real estate, and other community initiatives of Boston working class communities of color and ourselves. Fundamental to this endeavor is trust. Before credit scores, before FICO, before Equifax, the act of lending was personal, and qualification was grounded in the sense of a person's character, their work ethic, their trustworthiness. The enslavement of Black people, who were the capital, the credit, the product, and the business, precluded Black people from being properly recognized as deserving of opportunities to fulfill our dreams and receive investment. While Ujima is focused on people of color writ large, we recognize that it is a pervasive anti-Blackness that accompanies white supremacy, which undergirds systems and must be disintegrated. Here I hearken to Black Lives Matter. Black Lives Matter is the pursuit of lived love and freedom. Externally, it is a clarion call for the state and our representatives to do their jobs and notice that if they do not, business as usual will not continue. This movement for Black Lives has increased my faith in our ability to shift our collective culture towards care and concern for all. And as Black Lives Matter is not just a courageous public embrace of our inherent, undebatable values as human beings, but also an affirmation within our communities and an embrace of each other, Black Trust is an external and, more importantly, internal declaration of commitment. And we place it in the lineage of Black love, Black excellence, and Black joy. What do we hope to accomplish? We are in the midst of a paradigm shift and a reclamation of power in every aspect of our lives. We plan to see our agenda through cooperative economics, solidarity economy, economic democracy will become household terms. Relationships will not be transactional or zero-sum. Relationships will be organized around and incentivized by mutual and healthy benefit. We will trust each other. Black trust. Now we go into our program. So, Boston, WGBH, for Harriet and the Boston Globe. She is a proud member of the Dramatists Guild and Actors Equity Association, and Obegi is originally from Lowell, Massachusetts. So, we'll begin with a reading from Obegi Janice.
Voicemail. Daddy. Lynn embodies her father.
Mommy says you are struggling. I know we are not named, but remember, people love you. You have friends, right? You have people who look up to you, right? People who can check up on you. Hold on to them. Please, call us.
Scene 3. An empty, gutted hair salon in Mattapan, Massachusetts. The floor is black and white, checkered tile. We see stacks of foldable chairs in one corner, a water cooler in another corner, and Bibles in a pile. Lynn enters. She looks around. She inspects the space. Charlie and Jelani enter. Jelani wears a baby Bjorn. There's a four-month-old inside named Baby Malcolm. They see Lynn, but don't recognize her.
Looking for someone? Are you lost?
Wait, Charlie? Jelani? Oh my god!
Oh, there? Is that you, girl?
Oh my god, Jelani, it's Oma!
Nah, baby, it can't be.
It is, it's me, Oma.
What?
The three of them hug.
Oh, sorry about the baby, I didn't crush him, did I? And oh my god, y'all are parents?
Proud.
So proud.
Wow.
Girl, where have you been? We haven't seen you in a minute, we miss you.
Malcolm, say hello to Auntie Omega.
Baby Malcolm gives another little newborn sound.
Wait, did you name him after Malcolm X?
No, girl, Malcolm Jamal Warner.
We love that dude. Always loved the young man.
But isn't he with Regina King?
Good choice.
Very good choice.
I mean, we used to love Malcolm X.
We still do, right, baby?
Of course. My brother was still the truth. He still is.
No, I remember. In high school, y'all were 5%ers. Charlie, you tied up your hair just like Erica Badu. And then I could have sworn y'all were a mix of Nation of Islam and a new Black Panther movement or something. Jelani, though, your Facebook posts were so crazy for a few years.
Bush era. That man was a damn fool. Messes with you, you know?
It was actually kind of good. The exploring, the that Black centricity. It was all about knowing yourselves, you know? We were keeping saying, you know, trying to find purpose and stuff. But now,
she motions to the salon.
We doing this.
Doing what?
Read the sign, Olivo.
Welcome to the well. We love Jesus and we love people. That's it. We hope to see you soon. Wait, is this a church?
Church plant.
Like a storefront church?
Church plant.
It's not official or anything. We're just in the community, seeing what folks need, and then we'll launch.
Like a startup?
Not really. We don't make money. We just try to help people. You should come.
Sure. Sure, I'm not around a lot these days, but I'll try.
You visiting from New York or something?
No, I live here.
Where?
Here.
But well, we ain't seen you.
Oh, I live in Somerville.
Oh, Somerville.
Because if you were really back in town, we would have run into each other a long time ago. Because I would have felt awful if you were like that, mad and greedy. Happy, you know what I mean?
Exactly.
Y'all are the worst. I mean, can I live?
In Mattapan, yes.
I don't love it, but it's near work. It makes it easier to get to work.
I feel you, girl. That's why we never left Mattapan. I'm a teacher at Young Achievers.
English?
You better believe it. I love reading and writing so much. I teach it.
Badass kids, though.
Just evil.
I'm up there visiting, checking up on my wife, because you always pay lunch, baby.
I'm a busy woman.
But they love her up there.
And we love being here.
Blue Lab is home. And we ain't leaving.
What are you up to, Jelani? Did you ever take the police exam?
No. My heart couldn't take it. You know, they're doing too much. I prayed about it, though, and God said not to rule it out.
But I want Malcolm to get a little older before I apply again. You know, I'm part-time at the church and full-time with my little man.
Our daycare center down there in the street, you know. See it?
Down, just down the street.
Well, it's gone. New landlord, raised the rent, renovated. And we shopped around, but Miss Martha really loved the hookup. And she was a former teacher, so she didn't just put TV and walk away. She would talk to the kids, like adults. You know, it's the best way to get the vocabulary up, right?
Right.
But then, poof, gone. She closed about a month ago.
Wow.
It is what it is. And these other places are doing too much. But we don't have many options. Daycare is expensive, too much on our budget. But the truth, I love staying home. I know there's all this mess going on about black men being bad fathers, but nobody, not my wife, not my community, ever told me that spending time with my son during the day is unique. Not unique.
You're right.
Men in general got issues. That's just a fact. Men all over the world got issues. But I'm not some exception. I'm doing what God called me to do. Be a father. That's my charge. That's my job. Like the media, the government. No disrespect, but they don't know what they're talking about.
Someone said some foolishness to him last week when he came to visit me at school.
I was telling this young lady what she teaches Charlie, math or something. You know, she's not from here. One of those people from Boston teacher residency, she's actually from Portland, Maine, right? And I tell her just to be mindful, you know, with her words, because people listen to you and taking what you say more than you know. It hurt. You know, I don't like being told who I am. You know, don't tell me who I am, you know?
Remember when people at school used to call me African Booty Scratcher? Or Nala from The Lion King? I went to Nigeria once, and then all these kids...
Black and white.
All these kids trying to call me names.
Girl, they said we smelled. Who told these kids back in the 90s Haitians smelled? What kind of mess is that?
My dad said it always... My dad always said it must be their parents.
No, Lynn, it's deeper than that. These kids don't even know our history. They don't know shit about the Haitian Revolution, how we keep the shit out of those colonizers. They know nothing about Toussaint.
Baby, the swear.
Well, I'm being real right now, you know? I just can't hold in my cusses because I had a little tiny monster come out of my body.
You right. Shit! Now, I mean, Lynn, I don't know if you know this, but delivering a baby is difficult as hell.
Diapers, Lynn. I wore an adult diaper for 2 weeks. 2 weeks, just next.
Baby.
I'm just saying, I literally have to force feed my students some good literature, slip them some Edwige Dantka, just to make sure they can recite some Chinua Achebe in class. I don't even put it on the syllabus, that's how radical I am.
I love this woman.
Because if I don't, they're gonna think we trash. They're gonna think my Melvin, my little baby, is a smelly Haitian trash. Now that's some bullshit.
What you working on, Malego? I can tell you're working on something.
How you know?
Her eyes. She's with us, but she's not with us. They're the mid eyes. Just real inky.
Is he right or not?
He is, actually. I took a break from working on my algorithm. Just needed to walk around.
See? Man, genius, baby.
I sure did.
They kiss. Baby Malcolm cries.
Ooh, girl, we gotta go. Fussy baby. We miss you, though. It's really been too long. Oh, how are your parents?
They're good. Don't they live around here?
Ooh,
maybe we can crash their house and get some of that good food? Your dad made the best food.
They're traveling.
Oh, okay. Well, here.
Charlie hands Lynn her card.
This is a really nice card, Charlie.
Discipline, girl. But I told them to put on that heavy stock. I'm classy like that.
This woman?
Call me. I don't know if you have our number. You kind of fell off. But we see you. We read about you anytime an article drops about all your apps and stuff. We are so proud of you. If you need anything, call me.
I'll try.
Don't try. Just do.
Scene 4. That night. Workspace. Lynn is alone. She opens her laptop. Blue light floods her face. Comfort. She records herself. We watch her film an application video in real time while the feed floats above her head, projected onto one of the whiteboards.
Hey, my name is Lynn, and I'm the founder and CEO of Neighbor. Neighbor is an app and an algorithm that knits people together. We utilize social impact investing, to change the lives of residents of Roxbury, Dorchester, and Mattapan, where I was born and raised. Neighbor tackled gentrification head on with a radical and disruptive model of engagement and connection. We will unite generations, empower residents, and give ownership to those who work so hard to make a living and a life in this city. I know, Boston is changing. That's a fact. But why? And who bears the brunt? Think of the following terms for a second. Revitalization, urban renewal, development, gentrification. Think about them again. What are the common denominators? Race, color, ethnicity. Our city on the hill is alive. We are not excellent. We are flawed. From the Mayflower to busing, our progressive city is actually quite conservative and very backward. Certain people have agency and the rest don't. We can do better. But for some of us to do better, we may need to do it by ourselves and for ourselves. Now you may be asking me, why is this young black woman asking me, a white man, for money? Doesn't this venture need the dollars of a black man or woman? Sure it does. But because of systematic racism and oppression, my options are limited. I really wanted to ask a black man or woman to source the capital for Neighbor, but as of right now, they don't exist in your accelerator. See, I'm interested in legacy, in building legacy for my children and their children. One way of building legacy is to build bridges. Yes, I'm being contradictory, for us, by us, but it needs a little bit of seed money to make it happen. Yes, I am saying that. I am saying simply, partner with me. Examine your heart and mind, examine your values, and think about helping without being the white savior. Knowing that this is an investment in a shared future, in a shared economic health, and a dream of health and wealth for black people that directly affects how we do things in this city.
Fitting that Ujima is doing the work that you're doing here in Boston. And what I'm reminded of is before the Civil War, a bunch of activists created a cooperative commune in Western Mass, and Sojourner Truth worked there. Some of the people who came and spent time at that cooperative included John Brown. It included Frederick Douglass, and that became one of the sort of thought centers and organizing centers for what later became the Civil War. And it started, though, with a commune, a collective effort in a small town in Western Massachusetts. Also, it's significant that we're having this conversation here and you're doing the work you're doing here, because actually a lot of people in Boston were leading thinkers during the Civil War, and they were the people that W.B. Du Bois called the democratic abolitionists. And he called democracy abolition democracy. And if you look at the original debates and arguments in Congress and elsewhere leading up to the Reconstruction Amendments, like the 13th Amendment. What they were fighting for in the 13th Amendment was not just to eliminate chattel slavery. They said they wanted to eliminate all forms of labor that resembled slavery. It was a much further reaching amendment than the way the courts have interpreted it and the way we teach it in school. That was the whole idea of the 13th Amendment. And the Civil War was not just about freeing slaves, it was about changing capitalism. And to this day, it was the biggest liberation of capital, where $200 billion in slave property were just wiped out through the efforts led by these folks from this town. So I say that to say, this is a long tradition we're standing on here. We didn't start any of this, but I'm really happy that you all are continuing this fight. So I wanted to begin by just talking about what's going on in the economy overall. And labor unions got on a mass footing in the United States about 100 years ago in the textile industry in this part of the country. Places like Lawrence, Fall River, Providence, all the way down to New York City. Then business owners realized they could make greater profits taking advantage of racial segregation in the South, where labor organizers were lynched and black workers were violently repressed and got paid next to nothing. So the textile industry moved south. When I left college, that's one of the things I worked on, was organizing in places like North Carolina, Virginia, South Carolina. That's where the textile mills were. That's where the industry stayed until the 1970s, and then they began moving the textile mills to countries where labor was even cheaper, places like Peru or parts of Asia and elsewhere. The factories moved for a combination of reasons. For one, there was a civil rights movement in the 1960s that won rights for black workers that made it harder to repress black labor any longer. So it was clear that labor would not be so cheap in the South. Another reason is that the US and European countries initiated in the early 1960s a 10-year project, and literally the Treasury Departments, a bunch of business leaders of the G20 met every 6 weeks for 10 years in order to establish the legal and financial infrastructure needed to easily move money and goods across borders. This was the backbone of what we now call globalization. But I want to point out, it was a 10-year sustained intellectual project to figure out how to create the infrastructure, financial and legal and political infrastructure, to enable what we now call globalization. I say that because a lot of activists go to these things called World Social Forum or these gatherings and spend a week, and have some conversations, and they think that's like serious. No, what the bourgeoisie did was serious. It was 10 years, every 6 weeks, and I think we need to understand what it really takes to change big things in the economy. Then there were advances in science and technology, things like computers, advances in shipbuilding and telecommunications that made it easier to organize global operations for big companies. Since the 1970s, we've seen all kinds of businesses, manufacturing businesses, leave the United States. With the advent of microelectronics today, things like the internet and smartphone and digital kinds of manufacturing and other things, even more jobs are going to be eliminated in the near future. Robots will soon stock shelves in the big box stores. Walmart is already introducing robots to stock shelves in their stores, and it's only a matter of time you'll see it in all kinds of stores. Your radiology scan is already being read in some cases in India, and on and on. This is bound to keep happening during capitalism because businesses are in business to make a profit, and it's cheaper to automate and digitize than not to. My point about all of this is that competition and the drive to make profits leads businesses to constantly find ways to reduce costs and apply new technologies to make more money. this at the same time, there's a big problem in this, or contradiction in this. The problem is that under capitalism, businesses have to sell products in order to make a profit. And when you substitute machines and robots for workers, workers have less money to buy products. And workers are consumers. When a worker leaves a job and goes home, that's the consumer market. It's the same people. When you lay off workers, you have less consumer purchasing power. So eventually, the more advanced and high-tech the economy becomes, the harder it is to sustain profits and keep the system going. And like I said, under capitalism, the pressure to introduce technology, lay off workers, drive down costs is constant. But at the same time, once you do that, it's harder and harder to sell things. It's harder and harder to maintain a profit. This problem is the major underlying contradiction or problem in the economy. And there is no way out of it within the confines of profit making. Because profits are harder and harder to make in the traditional productive, or what some people call the real economy, big business and Wall Street have gone heavily into speculation. That's what led to the 2008 crash. Bitcoin, by the way, is like now it's, last week it was 10,000, now it's 20,000. Facebook went from a $4 billion valuation in 1 year and they were like 40 billion a year later. I guarantee you, nothing happened inside Facebook that justified an increase in their valuation from $4 billion to 40. It's speculation. Wall Street is also marketing what some people call fictitious capital. Fictitious capital is what Puerto Rico owes its lenders, $27 billion, I think. I believe Nigeria owes over $50 billion to banks. And in 10 years, Nigeria will owe more than $70 billion because of compound interest. This is fictitious because no way in hell is Nigeria going to pay back $50 billion. That's not going to happen. And Puerto Rico is not going to pay back $27 billion. That's not going to happen. And it's the same thing that happened in 2007, 2008, when banks had what were called toxic mortgages. They put these high interest mortgages on people who had no way of paying whatsoever and didn't even know they were getting hit with those kinds of charges, and they kept it on their books like that's real money. When actually, there's a lot of this kind of fictitious capital floating around the system. And the bigger thing right now is crony capitalism. And that's when big business pays off politicians to stop taxing them so they can make up for their shrinking profits by free riding on government. I mean, need I mention the current Republican tax bill in Congress? Or they pay politicians to privatize public goods like highways, bridges, hospitals, public schools, insurance. You know, they want to say if you're pregnant, you can't get insurance. Or if you have a prior illness, you can't have insurance because insurance needs to be profit-making. Wall Street is going into these things because it's harder and harder for them to make profits in the traditional economy. So they want government to privatize everything so they can just ride on the back of government. A bridge is great because people have to cross a bridge to get to work. And then if you don't pay the toll when you get off the bridge, the cops are right there. You know, or they either take your picture or arrest you on the spot. And then if you own that and you're a bank or a private finance, that's wonderful. The government actually, locks people up or fines them and does all that stuff, and all you do is collect money. These are things that used to be done for free or provided at cost. All of this amounts to stripping away the gains working people made over the last 100 years under the false pretense of fiscal austerity. The austerity is entirely artificial. It is self-induced by our refusal to tax the wealthy. Republicans like Paul Ryan and Ted Cruz justified this with a kind of religious fervor. Everything must be done through the market. The market is God. Capitalism is God. Government is the devil. Taking away money from God and giving it to the devil is evil. And I'm not exaggerating, that's literally the rhetoric. That's literally the rhetoric. Roy Moore was even worse than that. It is important not to be led astray by appearances or by the rhetoric in Washington, D.C. We are a very rich country. Fiscal austerity is not necessary. Unemployment and low wages are not necessary. We do not have a scarcity problem. These are all self-induced issues, problems. The stores are full. Our productivity and capacity has never been higher. Because of science and technology, the annual corn harvest in Kansas alone can produce 139 billion loaves of bread every year. The Household Wealth Survey released last week showed that household wealth in the United States reached nearly $100 trillion, the highest recorded. Yet, literally all of the gains being made in the last 10 years have gone to the already wealthy people, have gone to the wealthy. In the same period of time, what they call the middle class lost 34% of its wealth. But meanwhile, the overall, though, wealth increased dramatically. It's just we didn't see it. We didn't get it. Rich people can only eat so much food. They can only drive so many cars. They can only live in so many houses. Now, Kerry, the former senator, he has 14 houses. That's a record for me. I don't know how he lives in, 14. But he can only do 14. Rich people can only stimulate the real productive economy a little bit. Meanwhile, working people have less and less money and are getting thrown into temporary jobs, often with no benefits, or permanent unemployment, more and more. So workers cannot access the material wealth of our society, even though the goods are plentiful. And that's because we've set up the system so that workers can only access goods by having money. And that means you have to have a job. And our ideology is that only the private sector provides jobs. Yet the private sector needs to employ fewer and fewer people. Do you understand the contradiction here?
Yes.
There is a straightforward alternative that can solve these problems. This would be direct government investment in public works, education, affordable housing, and healthcare. For the most part, on a public, nonprofit, or cooperative basis, the entire nation could be gainfully employed doing these things. The country needs a green infrastructure to deal with climate change. We need better rail and air transport. We need to educate young people and workers in STEM, because that's the future economy. We desperately need affordable housing and healthcare, especially as 80 million people will reach old age in the next 10 years. Most of this kind of work happens at the state and local level, which means we need a big expansion in the planning and investment capacity of state and local governments and major investments in nonprofits like colleges and community health agencies. We can't even begin to move in this direction until we beat back the big lie that public institutions are wasteful and unnecessary. The opposite is true. The most significant gains in productivity have come from science and technology. And science and technology inventions and discoveries come mainly from government-funded research and development. I'm at MIT. MIT wouldn't last 2 weeks without federal grants and subsidies. In addition, the tech world is discovering that the internet makes it possible
for thousands of engineers to collaborate on creating digital products, and the power of these open source collaborations are far beyond what even the biggest corporations can match. You know, originally there's an open source operating system called Linux. Some of you may have heard of. Initially, corporate America fought Linux tooth and nail. IBM, Apple, now they all use Linux. And Linux was created open source. The biggest corporations in the world could not compete with thousands of people sharing ideas, working together, and the internet made that possible. There's never been anything that productive, powerful in the history of humankind. What these techies are stuck on is how do you compensate people when you can't quantify everyone's particular contribution? If we're having a conversation of batting across ideas, you can't say, well, your idea is worth 62 cents, and yours is $1.03, and yours is 59. It doesn't make any sense. And what this calls for is something like a social wage and a social approach to development. The point I'm making is that we ought to be a flourishing people right now. We have the material and intellectual means to flourish, and instead we are sinking. We need to tax the rich and invest in the public sector and in the social, cooperative, and nonprofit sector. What's holding us back, literally, is ideology and politics. And that's what I want to go to now. I just mentioned, I want to talk about gender and the sharing and caring economy. I just mentioned the notion of a social wage and social economy. We've always had a social economy, we just didn't have a name. If you look at women and capitalism, capitalists segmented off work that couldn't be done for a profit and called it women's work. Raising children, taking care of the elderly, cooking, feeding, making beds, washing clothes, teaching children. This is work needed to reproduce the workforce. We don't have an economy without this work. All of this, though, is not profitable. And so it became women's work, which women were forced to do for free. This work was and is essential, but it's the social economy. Most of it is invisible to the GDP or Dow Jones Index because those things only measure work that generates profits. Yet, this work is vital for our survival, all of us, as a society. The social wage for women historically has been zero. Ideologically and culturally, men were said to be the heroic breadwinners or heroic soldiers. Women had little status at all, basically nothing more than their bodies. This ideology is why we today pay home care workers so little. Most work sub-minimum wage. It's why we pay kindergarten teachers so little. It's why we pay waitresses so little. It's not because their work has little value. It's because the value doesn't show up in profits. What is the value of a good teacher to your children, a good home care worker who comforts your grandmother? You can't put a price curve on that. We're not talking about widgets or commodities, we're talking about our children, our elders, our loved ones. This is a matter of social value and of our politics, of who we are. Now that women are demanding true equality, including economic equality, for the reproduction work that they still mainly do, women are running straight up against our profit system and against market fundamentalism, or what's called neoliberalism. And I will say, like, if you look at the women's marches and all of that, I'm not saying the women's movement as a whole is that's where their heads are right now, but that's where they're going. That's what they're running up against. The social economy is a care economy. Taking care of children, elderly, poor people, and needy people should not be subject to the market. The people doing this quote-unquote women's work should be paid as much as people who do profit-making work. And this is the critical responsibility of the public sector. This is why we have a government. The issue goes way beyond the behavior of Roy Moore or Harvey Weinstein in Hollywood. The struggle is about the basic structure of our economy and of our society. The war the Republicans are waging against the public sector is largely about redefining what government is. And it's hitting, eliminating the caring economy. They want to privatize all healthcare, education, insurance, as I said before. They want to break unions so that women's wages are kept on the floor in those sectors. They have to keep making high profits any kind of way, whether it's good for society or good for the environment. I won't even get into the environment tonight, but same set of problems. On race, race reveals the problems in our economy and society in a particularly striking way. Economics in a democracy, the economy in a democracy is supposed to support the common good. Money is supposed to be widely distributed so that people can flourish. That's the theory. Yet in practice, modern industry began with cotton, and cotton was built entirely on slavery and colonialism. Nothing could be further away from the democracy than this, and the idea of the economy being used for the common good disappeared. We've developed the idea that the economy is an amoral arena where it's survival of the fittest and greedy self-interest is the guiding principle. Black people never had a chance in capitalism. 290 million acres of land taken by force from Native Americans was distributed at little or no cost to white men before 99% of blacks could even own land. Millions of white veterans after World War II got zero interest home loans, while black veterans were mostly excluded or only allowed to buy homes in undesirable neighborhoods. This is the main reason why white median wealth today is about 25 times black median wealth today. In the 1980s, it was 11 times higher. Today, it's 25 times higher, which means there are some different dynamics happening in black communities and white communities, even though whites are going down, the middle class is going down. For black folks and for Latinos, the floor is falling. There's no wealth there. By the year 2050, blacks and Latinos are projected to have literally zero wealth. Absent a political intervention on the scale of the Civil War, black people will remain where they are. Black wealth today is about 2% of the overall national wealth. In 1868, 3 years after slavery, black wealth was about 2% of overall national wealth. In 1955, before the Civil Rights Movement, before there were black elected officials, the black income was on median 55% of white income. Today, black median income is 55% of white median income. And the Civil Rights Movement initially was all about economics. But that's been dropped, that's been lost. And we gotta be candid, black elected officials have not changed anything when it comes to dealing with these fundamentals. We haven't gone anywhere. The arguments used to justify racial inequality is that black people don't work hard, don't study hard, don't discipline our children, don't save and invest. These are popular and thoroughly racist arguments. The point I want to make, though, tonight is that these explanations that are used to justify racial inequality, like and similarly the ideas that justify women's oppression, are just as fundamental to the capitalist economic structure as money. Capitalism had to continually find ways to win over white workers to its side in a democracy. During slavery, somebody had to go catch the runaway slaves. Somebody had to enforce discipline and keep them on the plantation. How are you going to get poor white people to do that? Why would they do that? Why would they join in with the slaves? So capitalism created this notion of race. Whiteness did not exist as a concept until Thomas Jefferson and later Jackson created it. In order to justify, Jefferson said, I've got a great idea. What can I, a rich white slave owner, have in common with poor whites working in textile mills in New England versus slaves and versus Native Americans? I've got it. We're white. They're not. That was created in order, and we'll give these white men the vote. We'll give them things that make them feel a little bit up above these other people. That was essential in order to have an army, in order to have militias, in order to have police, in order to maintain the system. White men, for these reasons, what capitalism didn't create one working class or one proletariat, the way Marx talked about it when he was focused on Manchester, England. Capitalism created two proletariats, two working classes. The first consisted of black slaves and brown and yellow colonial subjects. And this was W.E.B. Du Bois's thesis, by the way, in the book he wrote on black reconstruction. The second proletariat consisted of white American and European workers. White men were given a supervisory role over the colored proletariat in the workplace and via government through the police and the military. This structure continues still. It is what underlies our continuing fights around police brutality, stop and frisk in New York, or mass incarceration. The underlying racial differences in black, Latino versus white communities is what structures politics in the United States. White workers do have more to lose than their chance. They can be treated like black people or like immigrant Latinos. Because of this two proletariat structure, black workers and most white workers have never been able to stay in a political coalition across this country for any length of time. Never. A majority of white workers have not voted for a Democrat for president since the Civil Rights Act passed in 1964. Without this division, we would have a very different politics. We would have a very different economy. Now that workers of color will be a majority in this country in a couple of decades, and among young workers, it's already happening, and in elementary school, it's happened. There is no way that any group of workers, white, black, Latino, have the support of the others. This is a new and unprecedented scenario for white workers. It is not new for workers of color. We've always known that we can't get very far with white workers in opposition. But this really is a new situation for most white people. I also think it's new for groups like the labor movement. Labor isn't going to survive without communities of color strongly supporting labor unions. But I don't think labor has processed this reality hardly anyway. The building trades, oh my God. I don't know if you saw them kissing up to Trump, you know, jumping up and down about building a wall and doing the pipeline and all that stuff, but it's a new low. The tradition of the white left has been to treat black people as an afterthought or a junior partner, whether in labor or politics. Bernie Sanders made this mistake. He said, free college tuition helps everybody. But in fact, this is a more important demand for young white people because a majority of young white people are in college. And the cost of loans is a huge issue. Not to say for those blacks who are in college, the cost of loans is not a huge issue, but this is an issue that affects most young white people. A majority of black kids are not in college because they can't get in the door. A lot of them are in jail or never got out of high school. And this is a key issue in black communities. Sanders talked a lot about raising the minimum wage. Again, good. But he didn't talk so much about permanent unemployment. Decades-long permanent unemployment is the number one issue in black communities. These discouraged workers are not even counted in unemployment statistics. You have to look at labor force participation rates. Labor force participation of healthy, active people, 25 through the 50s, has been at 60% in the black community for decades, many, many decades, which means 40% of able people aren't even in the workforce. Black labor force, Sanders could have done the reverse. He could have started talking about black workers on the very bottom for the last 400 years, and then worked his way up to free college tuition and the minimum wage. He could have signaled that it was important for him to address the continuing racial segmentation of our society. He could have made it clear that for him, black people were not an afterthought. Had he done so, I think he would have beat Hillary Clinton. Said it was a close primary race, and Sanders lost 75% of the black vote to Hillary Clinton. And also lost the Latino vote to Hillary Clinton, which was way above his margin of defeat. And Hillary was not a great candidate. It's not like, you know, there was just outpouring love in the black community for Hillary Clinton. But, you know, Sanders would have these rallies and say, I'm going to bring back good American jobs to, you know, American workers. And, you know, crowds are going, yeah, you know, white crowds, yeah. Wait a minute. I'm going to bring these jobs back from Mexico, whatever, you know, whatever. What do you have against Mexicans? If you're black, you got radar on that kind of stuff. You know, you hear that? You hear a bunch of white people cheering about, yeah, we're going to take something back from Mexico. You went, whoa, whoa. Wait. You know, Mexico, you're talking about us. I'm like, whoa. Right? So, Sanders, people have. So a key problem, by the way, I think Sanders would have beat Trump head to head. Awesome. Had he won the primary, I think he would have beat Trump. There's a lot of anger out there. Sanders is a lot more authentic in addressing working class anger than Trump. So a key problem we have is with white progressives, or actually the absence of white progressivism when it comes to race. I want to end where I began. There are solutions to the problems we face that are right in our face. Boston has 80,000 buildings in need of energy retrofit. This, when you retrofit a building, you save on average about 40% of your monthly energy bill. Those savings could pay for the cost of training the workforce, doing the labor, and loads of money left over in savings after that. It could employ a whole generation of young people coming out of high school in Boston. Boston is vulnerable to sea level rise, and it is going to happen. And there's a massive need for new infrastructure. The entire Back Bay is actually landfill, and it's going to disappear. People don't want to deal with that, but it's real, it's going to happen, unless new infrastructure is developed. The city needs affordable housing desperately. The city needs far better mass transit. New advanced manufacturing means that you will soon be able to design your own shoes or design your own electric car and have it quote unquote printed or produced right in your neighborhood. The shoe store will have a 3D printer or something. They'll make your shoe right there on the spot. And what is a gas station now? Cars are essentially the batteries, electronic components, some tires, slap them on, and a fiber optic body. They'll do that at a gas station. New houses will be built with precision cut materials and fit together like Lego, 90% cheaper to build than the way we do now, and 90% stronger than the way we build housing now. Whole generations of young and middle-aged workers need training and retraining in STEM to take advantage and actually to make these opportunities happen. We can have full employment, we can eliminate bad jobs. We have the financial wealth to do all these things and far more. I will point out to you that taxpayers paid literally $10 trillion in 2008 to bail out the financial sector. And without these bailouts, all these big banks would have gone under. We're not even living in competitive capitalism anymore. That's not capitalism. When you lose $1 trillion, you go out of business. These folks are still in business and even took their bonuses, all at taxpayer expense. So it's not that we don't have the money. Banks got $3 trillion at 0% interest since 2008 from the Federal Reserve. They haven't even invested. What if we did have $1 trillion that went into affordable housing and another trillion for energy efficiency and another trillion to deal with green infrastructure and on? It's not that we don't have the money. Actually, the federal government no longer prints money. People don't understand that. Very little. All new money comes through banks, which means that the federal government allow banks to make money, make loans, which means that all of it goes into profit-making activities because banks don't give loans unless you're going to make money. Right? All of it. It doesn't have to be that. What we need is the political will to tax the rich and redirect our savings and investments from Wall Street speculation into the public and social economy. Another thing folks don't realize, most of the money that's going for gentrification and luxury housing and forcing people out is labor pension money. There's a big deal that happened in New York City, I'm pretty familiar with, called Stuyvesant Town. It was like 10,000 units in Manhattan, 14th Street to 22nd Street, huge working class housing. It was sold in 2006 for $5.2 billion. The purchaser was Tisch & Speyer, a real estate company. They put up $28 million of their own money. The rest of the $5.2 billion came from NYSERS, New York City Employees Public Sector Workers Pension Funds, the Ontario Public Sector Workers Pension Fund, CalPERS, California School Teachers, Firefighters Pension Funds, the Anglican Church of England, and the Singapore Government Sovereign Fund. That's where the other 5.1 something billion came from. And that the Wall Street is using workers' own money to kick us out of our houses, right? And that's not just talking about taxing the rich, also taking control of our own savings, our own wealth, and raising our awareness about what our money is doing and redirecting it, which I know Ujima's all about that. Basically, we need to organize a movement to go in the exact opposite direction that the Republican Party is leading the nation right now. And that's what I'm here for. Thank you. But what I do know of it is that it will eliminate state and local deductions on your taxes, on your federal income tax, which will devastate Massachusetts. It will devastate California. It will devastate New York and other states that actually provide more services. It will lead to big layoffs, and when public sector unions will get hit really hard. Services will be cut significantly. It also defunds in a huge way healthcare for, you know, children, low-income people, disabled people, elderly people, massive cuts in healthcare, and it will produce a $1.5 trillion deficit on top of the existing deficit, which they will try and use to justify massive cuts on existing federal programs like HUD. You can kiss goodbye the affordable housing programs, all of that. It also eliminates deductions for charities, and so foundations will take major hits. So all these organizations that depend on foundation grants will get hit. And it's a continuation of the philosophy that Reagan's regime came up with, and his budget director, David Stockman, wrote a book about it. And David Stockman said, what we did, we calculated that the Democratic Party relies on unions, public sector unions, as its organizing troops. And so if we cut the social programs, number one, the recipients of those programs will be less motivated to vote. They will think government isn't doing anything for them. And cities and states will have to lay off public sector workers, which will hurt the capacity of public sector unions to organize and mobilize people. So we'll be able to defund the Democratic Party, defund our opposition through how we manipulate the budget. It's the same logic that's behind this tax bill. The idea is to, number one, eviscerate gains working people made, but also demobilize, deorganize the what's left of the organizational base of the Democratic Party. There, in my opinion, there are alternatives, ways to fight back, but that's another conversation. There is nothing legitimate about about who owns property. I gave an example, you know, property, unless you have, it doesn't exist without law. Laws are made by Congress. Congress is supposed to serve the people. They have tried to change election financing so that rich people can put unlimited amounts of money in and our votes don't matter. It's thoroughly corrupt right now. So we shouldn't give up all of that and just focus on cryptocurrencies. We need to take back the wealth of our nation. And we need to fundamentally change property laws, inheritance, and everything else to make a more equitable society that's actually better for everybody. We shouldn't give up on that. That being said, cryptocurrencies, what they can really do is enable people who want to collaborate and cooperate in a given locality or in a given sector or in the internet or anything else in order to do transactions, projects, businesses that can help people where we can define the rules ourselves. And that works where you don't have to rely or you don't need a lot of national currency in order to make to run your business or do the things you want to do. And cryptocurrencies are very useful for that. And basically, it's just a way of doing what the black church did 100 years ago. You know, where, you know, when my family moved from the South, nobody had money. So, and jobs were intermittent. And so people had rent parties, you know, and people would put a little money in, and the same for funerals and burials. And in my family, we did it for gas money. It was like people would pool money, and then, like, that's how you got money for gas. And then the churches, the trustee boards in the churches, were actually the respected people who helped organize economic activities amongst people in the church. And what cryptocurrency does, it basically allows you to do that in an easier way. And also with blockchain, it allows you to extend that in an easier way and do involving more people. You know how used to in church, I don't know if anybody went to church here, but you know how they used to do collections and they pass the plate?
Yeah.
All right, so cryptocurrencies and blockchains, you just automate passing the plate, you know? And those things are good for community level projects, but don't give up on the $10 trillion we just gave to Wall Street. We should not pit those things against each other or think that one is a substitute for the other, in my opinion. The second one, could you repeat?
Wealth construction typically involves theft and transfer, so who could be potentially harmed in the creation of black wealth?
No, not an
artist. Please,
professor. All right, so what was the first one? I actually think that is a question for us to talk about and work through and decide. The point I was trying to get across was that actually we really don't need ownership as we think of it now. We really don't need the category of worker. An owner now. We don't need it. We are a wealthy society. And the question of ethics extends to the whole world. So what is our ethical obligation to Central America, to Haiti, to Africa, to all these other places? That needs to be part of the conversation. God didn't put oil under the earth for Exxon. You know, so all of these questions we need to engage in and make decisions as society, as people. And we can. That's my point. And that is the ethical thing to do, in my opinion. Secondly, I personally don't think black people get wealthy. This is what I was saying earlier. Black people don't get wealthy unless Latino people get wealthy, unless Asian people get wealthy. With no single group of us can actually solve our problems by ourselves. Understanding that is fundamental to changing politics in this country. We all need each other, whether we like it or not. And that needs to be the message, you know, I think. And I actually think we should be going out talking to those Alabama low-income white workers who all they've heard is Rush Limbaugh and Fox News. And we ought to let them know we care about them. And we need them, actually, because we can't win without them. And we need to let them know, though, you can't win without us. That needs to be the message. And when you approach it that way, it kind of doesn't matter what your issue is. If your issue is gay rights, if your issue is the environment, if your issue is civil rights, if your issue is employment or schools, it doesn't matter, really. Because you're not going to win on any of that unless you support these other people's issues. And that's the understanding we need to get across. We need each other more than we need a win on anything we think is important to me or important you think is important to you. None of that matters if we're not together. So the first thing we need to do is understand that. We've got to be together. And that's the ethical challenge. You know, and that is really goes against the whole ideology of capitalism. And right now, the ideology of capitalism is the main obstacle. They haven't pulled tanks out in the street yet.
They have.
I'm serious. I'm being literal about that.
Yeah.
I work in Colombia where two people a week are still being murdered. And I'm not saying that's not a possibility, but honest to God, it's not the same here as there. Now, I'm not saying it couldn't be. We need to take full advantage of what we still can do here and not be trivial about that or assume that it's always going to be that way. And I started off as an organizer with five of my friends being murdered in North Carolina in 1979. I'm very clear on what could happen. And it is happening in Colombia, on the Pacific Coast where we're working. It is happening there. It's not happening here yet, but it could.
I guess I'm thinking of the artillery and the militia-ness yeah. that happened in Ferguson and that happened in Baltimore. Yeah. Like that feels like an attack on black bodies.
Right.
It's a comment on money, it's a comment on power. So no, you're right, it's not at that level. And I think I struggle to be in this generation and to feel a sense of danger being a black woman. And feeling that my body and my presence and my power is always in opposition to white bodies. And it has to do with money.
But I do sometimes struggle with some folks in Black Lives Matter and other organizations and saying, it's not about being on MSNBC. You know, it's not about who is the spokesperson, who's out front. We actually, in terms of dealing with what you're talking about, we actually are going to have to, I think, deliberately start having some people be very invisible in order to really deal with some of those things that you're talking about and begin preparing ourselves for that. I've said to some labor unions that represent security guard workers, we need to start training security guards politically in a whole different way. And that needs to be done, et cetera. So,
mm-hmm. I've heard that too.
Yeah.
Hi. Thank you both so much for your talk and your presentation. So, my question is, I was thinking about this politically, but I think you could also probably answer as an artist this tension between new economy and make something new or maybe refer to what's existed before versus political participation. When in the context of art, I think a lot about creating your own spaces versus participating in maybe more white and mainstream spaces. But I would be really curious, maybe if both of you with those different perspectives, just because you touched on before, Professor, about how you know people who are disenfranchised, they stop believing in the political system, but then also the benefits of the new economy, and creating a new economy and divesting somewhat, but it also sounds
say who's the things I'm thinking about right now. A best of, we can think BuzzFeed, a best of list on Essence just released of like 33 top women of color in the wellness industry, right? And that's important because wellness is white, and yoga is white, and taking care of yourself is white, and veganism is white. Like, I'm saying this with quotations. So I think that what's happening is Black people continue to make new things because it's just survival. So we're just trying to take care of ourselves. But what's happening in a really great way too is that economically, it's just like we make our own thing and then it comes back to us. So I'm seeing my colleagues make partnerships and collaborations with Nike, with Google, like people are popping into Facebook, but the money is going to them. So I see it less as like, they were trying to create content for white spaces, but they're making Black content and then the white spaces are taking notice and just giving us our money. In terms of content, I always tell people that ask me for advice, I just tell them, please make your own work. And it's not because like being on YouTube, Vine, Rest in Peace, and others is going to like give you your fame. It's not about fame, but it's about your identity and your validity. And from that quality work comes money, just instantly. I have never once, from the work that I've done, not made income from that. Does that make sense? So it's like, I think that what's happening is the new way is what needs to happen, is being really clear about who you're working for, who you're creating for. I think the reason why we've seen so many, I'm a Black woman, so I say the Black woman, but or not actually out there with Donald Glover, but the reason why we're seeing like 2017, this really flagship year for Black creators, is it's because the work is good. So the work was, we're consuming Awaken My Love, like that is good work. It was always good, but now we're figuring out, oh, we need to give Issa Rae like our dollars. We need to buy Awaken My Love. So I think that we Black people are setting the tone and then people are following, but we still don't care if they're following or not. So I see that as something new. It's something new for me. I know that in the past, in the 90s, this is not really my point of creative inspiration, but for some people, the 90s and like pre-UPN or whatever, like that was huge, like Living Single. But I think what's exciting about the internet and about content creation is that there is like instant money and cash flow in that. So be it that your friend wants to do a Fenty tutorial, don't knock your friend who is trying to, you know, help like figure out how to get Rihanna's followers on her page. She's making money. So I see that as a disruption of those white dollars, of that white gaze, and it's just completely making something new, and I hope it continues.
Well, two things I want to say is that I think art is incredibly important to how we engage people and sort of get people to think about these issues and think about them differently. And most of what we hear on TV and the political rhetoric is itself aesthetic. I mean, when they're talking about the tax budget, they're not going through all the stuff they did. They're creating images and so forth. And a lot of times it's religious images, like I was saying before. Yeah. It's all aesthetics, you know? It is art. It is art, actually. And I just think we have to be much better at that. But I also want to say that 25 years ago, I was the manager of public housing for New York. And 11 years ago, I did a project with the residents of public housing in New York. And the residents said they want to purchase their cable TV phone service as a group. And so I actually got a student at the time, Randall Pinkett, who went out and tested Time Warner and the other companies and said, what would that contract for all the households and public housing be worth to you to provide cable, et cetera, et cetera. This was 11 years ago. They said $32 million a year. That would go right to the Tenants Association. And then we asked the Tenants Association, if you get $32 million a year, like, what are your priorities? What do you want to do? The first thing they said, number one, they want their own TV station. They want their own news, they want their own culture on TV, which I thought was amazing, that they were like very clear that what they were getting is not, they were being fed stuff. and they wanted their own voice and to have their own images, etc. Now, it turned out the guy who was working on this project, Randall Pinkett, went on The Apprentice and was the first black person to ever win on The Apprentice. And then he ran off to do a hotel with Donald Trump. It was a disaster. And he actually organized last year other Apprentice winners to denounce Trump. And then Katrina happened. But we're trying to revive that now in New York to exactly that approach, which I call collective community bargaining. It can happen here. You know, Facebook, Google, every time you make a choice on Google, that information is stored. And then it is put into an algorithm, and then sold to advertisers and others who want to reach you. And we don't organize Google users collectively to bargain over that. That's money. The way they designed the system is they use our behavior and our actions to actually cash in, you know, by targeting us as consumers. There are so many fronts where we can organize communities to get money back. From the cable companies, from the cell companies, from the Googles, from the others, immense amounts of money. And then we can fund organizing without having to go to foundations, without, you know, having to pass the hat, et cetera. And there's a lot of money there in these things, so.
I was once on a panel with a BET executive, and he was really trying to clarify for the audience, when one of our shows premieres, if you don't watch it that night, like he said, it could be canceled like tomorrow. And you won't even know until 6 months later that it was already canceled. So like the episodes of it. So that really struck me. And then it even struck me with Girls Trip this summer that, and you need to keep your eyes on Will Packer because he's about to run everything and they're scared, they're so scared. But Will Packer funded, because he didn't ask for favors, he funded Girls Trip. He supported Malcolm Levy and the young lady striker, off of that girl. But that alone, like the fact that black people came out in droves, and then by some grace of God, these white people were like, oh, black women like to have fun, that's interesting. Like they didn't know that we go out to party in New Orleans. But the thing is that we set the tone. So that black money that made this really interesting film, like because that first weekend was so powerful, that set the tone for like the next 10 years. Which is more black people getting paid.
I know you have a question. I just want to point out. Last year, 1199, the Union Hospital Workers, which is headed nationally by an African-American guy who grew up, you know, in Virginia, working class guy. Last year, they invested $250 million in a German manufacturing firm. They haven't invested in that amount of money. Their members are 90% low-income people of color, mostly women. They don't put those kinds of investments in communities where their members live. 15 years ago, the New York Daily News was up for sale. Bill Cosby was trying to organize a buying group to buy NBC. It was up for sale. So there was a meeting of black labor leaders in New York. Do you want to buy the Daily News? Do you want to buy NBC? Do you want to put money in and buy NBC? They have money. 1199 is a $13 billion pension fund. They have the money. You know what they said? The labor leader said, the head of ASCA at the time from New York said, why do I want to buy a newspaper? We don't have anything to say. That's why I say the issue is ideology and politics. It's not that we don't have access to money. It's not that we can't invest. It's not that we can't actually have our own meeting. It's not that we can't do these. We don't have the consciousness to actually work together and do that stuff. That's the problem.
Thank you.
And pray for the lonely, I'm being real with you, pray for the lonely hours in the writing cave. Because it's lonely, it's hard, but the pages are coming. And it's a commission from Speakeasy Stage Company in Boston, so if they're smart, they'll produce it. If not, it is fine. I will shop it around to other places. But yeah, it's in progress, and I'm being supported, like director-wise, whatever, et cetera. And there may be a public reading in April, so you just have to keep in touch with me.
I say that because they're being mobilized against us. And, you know, this tax bill, is going to be devastating for a whole lot of people. A lot of people depend on Medicaid for their mother to be in a nursing home. There is a danger of physical repression. And they will mobilize those same people to come in and shoot us, you know, when we're protesting on the street, which was your point earlier. And yes, we will survive, we've survived in the past, but how much progress have we made in America? I just went through a lot of statistics. Where are we in the hierarchy in America? I think that if we can't win away white workers from where they're heading right now, we are going to be hit hard. That's what I'm saying. I'm not saying we don't have any capacity. I'm not saying, you know, we got to rely on them. I'm kind of saying something else. What I'm saying is black folks are the most politically conscious group in America as a whole. 85% of black people in polls are class conscious. 85% of black people say America is a class society. They understand white people are oppressed. 30% of white people understand. 85% of black people understand. 85% of black people say, white people, you are oppressed. Only 30% of white people say that about themselves. 90-some percent of black people say America is a racially stratified society. So black folks don't pit class against race. Black folks understand there's a dynamic that goes on between race and class in America. Not a lot of groups in America understand. And so what I'm saying is that not only do we have to look out after ourselves, it would be wise of us, while looking out after ourselves, if we outreach to white workers, to white folks, and really try and help them to understand they'll be much better off working with us as opposed to going at us. And I was in Alabama recently speaking to a group of low-income white workers. And I said, I understand you elected Trump, you wanted to send us black folks a message. We've got it. But in Alabama, 62% of people on Medicaid are white. It's you. Do you understand? I know Trump's kicking our ass. Do you understand he's kicking your ass? Do you understand? These tax breaks for billionaires or multimillionaires, how many of them do you have in Alabama? They live in Massachusetts. They live in New York. That money's not coming to you. And in fact, I guarantee you, Massachusetts and New York, when this tax bill goes through, they're going to raise taxes on millionaires and billionaires in New York and Massachusetts. So we will get some of that money back. You're not getting shit. And do you know what? They said, will you come back?
Actually, this tells me, I was trying to think, because a follow-up is, your essentially challenging us to speak to poor white people like we speak to each other in private.
Thank you.
All right, I'll do that.
Thank you.